This is Beachhead of the G.I. Joe team, and you are in the clutches of Cobra Mind Control with Dr. Mindbender watching Pino Comics. So break free of that mind control and click on any one of those other videos you see off to the right.
This is G.I. Gary with Pina Comics and another G.I. Joe review. Today I'm going to be looking at the 2003 G.I. Joe MUV, or Military Utility Vehicle. It is a remote-controlled Jeep-like vehicle that was released during the G.I. Joe versus Cobra Spy Troops line. And because it's from 2003, it is considered part of the new sculpt era when the figures weren't quite the original O-ring style. These are generally have a different sculpt where the shoulder seems to be bigger and the legs seem to be a little longer, waist seem to be a little shorter. Still an O-ring construction. Plastic's a little different, but that's the figures. But today we're going to take this guy out of the box and give it a spin and give it a good hot take review and see what have you, and if this is actually a good toy for G.I. Joe collection. Initially, I got it in the box here. I found this online. Somebody was clearing out, and this was cool for me because I didn't have a remote control G.I. Joe toy. I don't have the 1987 Crossfire, along with the Hover Strike, which is actually a remote controlled hovercraft. Really interesting. I've seen them for sale locally, but they weren't working, so I haven't picked up one of those yet. This is the first remote control vehicle, G.I. Joe vehicle I've bought, and looking forward to opening it up and taking it out and getting a good hot review out of this, and if it belongs in everybody's or nobody's or just mine, or I don't like it, I don't know yet, but collection.
Okay, let's take a closer look at the MUV. Before we open it up out of the box, we can look at how it was displayed on shelves and presented to consumers in 2003. But looking at the box, this is the way it's supposed to fit, would be facing out on the shelf. Kind of an odd way to display a Jeep or a vehicle is, you're looking at the top. You can see it's ages 6+, action figures included, and caution, electric toy, which is still in a warning or caution message that's still very large on current toys. It looks like it was a sticker applied across the clear plastic and the green cardboard. There's a rechargeable battery and charger included. We're going to see how in 2019, if 16 years in its plastic and cardboard prison, it has, if it's still good to be used or not. It's, big green box, tough enough to complete any mission, fits multiple figures and all G.I. Joe and Cobra 3¾ action figures. So break some guys out and see how many we can fit in there. So we'll look over here. We got a nice action shot of it in action, which looks more like a stationary shot where they just blurred the wheels and put the picture of the MUV in the comic verse, because that is comic style art in the background. And again, they're definitely stressing the fits multiple figures. So in the back, of the box, we can see the sort of a blueprint style back with telling you all about the G.I. Joe MUV. It's a fully functional radio control, and it is bi-directional controller, and it's easy to hold, and it looks good. Well, they're talking about the controller looking good, which is kind of odd, but Special Forces MUV is armed for battle and can withstand the desert heat and the jungle humidity. Lead reconnaissance missions into enemy territory. and watch the enemy scurry for cover. Foot pegs allows you to carry additional troops on the vehicle. So break through enemy lines and be the hero today. So you can see that it's got a turning machine gun turret, seats two patrollers and one gunman, removable gear, and again, more foot pegs. And then also on the back, it's for the driver Beachhead. We got his file card. And some poses may require hand support. Product and colors may vary. And we got this side, which is another repeat on that side. And then the bottom. And then the bottom of the box. You know, so pretty much you got your UPC, you know, clip that, you know, you got the little dash marks, but no, at this point, no flag points. And another look, you know, I would normally expect on the shelf, this is more of the way I would think that it would have been displayed, but, well, I'm not Hasbro. That's taking a peek at the MUV inside the box.
All right, took a look at the outside of the box. Now we can dig in. So I already cut the tape holding the flap. I'll get some initial impressions of now that it's coming outside. Oh, first thing I notice is we have a pamphlet. It's not quite a blueprint, but it does show a couple of things about use of the electronic feature of the toy, the remote control. The packaging got a little crushed on it when it came in the mail. So there's that. And well, we got first breath of fresh air. It's held together by twist ties for the most part, little bands. So, and even Beachhead here. So we got a I got a bunch of wiring to undo, so I might as well untie it. It's tied in knots. So here is the attractive remote control as advertised, with a very long wire just bent on a little spring here. So, and they got the controller, and it's, you know, there's a little sticker here that says tough enough to complete any mission. So I don't know. I don't think airstrikes are in the MUV's future, but if it's tough enough to do an airstrike, if I had a helicopter and I dropped it from 20 feet, I don't know. I think it would break. Where else we got? Wow, as you can see, there's a lot of these wires. Right now, it's like bringing hands to a plier fight. All right. Ta-da. All right. Yeah, taking these plastic guys off. Now, I am generally a loose collector. I'm not a huge mint in package collector, so I'm sure somebody out there is cringing, but I think that there's plenty of these available still. Somebody really wants one of these in package, you know I'll let you know if it's better to just keep it in the package. All right, get these wires off. Oh, goody, the front ones are wrapped through the front bumper. So there, wow, this is actually got some heft to it. Got some, like a hard rubber tire on a plastic rim. So that's nice. I was wondering if the wheels were going to be hard plastic. The tires would be hard plastic. They got some give. They're a little stiff. But we got that going on. Now let's just get old Beachhead out here. Now that I know how they fasten them. And again, you know, it is a new sculpt. And in my experience, and I actually am not against the new sculpt G.I. Joes. I actually like them. I think as a toy, I think Hasbro was on the right way. The problem was they did such a good job previous to this that it just turned off a lot of G.I. Joe collectors. They just didn't have that same look and feel as they did you know, back in the 80s. And there we go. So now beachhead is free. And this is a neat little interesting fact. They put a little piece of Mylar plastic in between beachhead, who's brandishing the G.I. Joe logo across his back. And he looks pretty good. Again, new sculpt, smaller head, bigger shoulders, a little bit of shorter waist and long legs. The legs look a little bow-legged, but hey, you know what? It's pretty cool. I think it's a pretty good color choice, and actually some nice sculpt. I'll get a close. We'll do a close-up again. Before, here's this. So that's out. And then we got, oh, there's still more in here. Still got the accessories. So we got an extra seat. We got a ammo can. And then we got the roll bar machine gun, which I believe, we'll look at the instructions real quick. Yeah, there's no instructions in this. So what I see is what I get. So here we have that. And this guy's just going to go snap on here in just a sec. Come on, snap. So this is something. Plastic's a little rubbery here. This is a little rubbery, but it's not stiff. It's not like like when I open the Fun School up. So this is nice. And oh, look, you got your main cannon here, then you got your machine gun here. So that's cool. And you can adjust your elevation going up and down the roll bar. And you can even slide it up and down the roll bar. So if you want it in the center or off to the left or right, you can do that. And doesn't really tell you where to put these. I'm going to have to look at the picture on the back of the box for that. So it's showing that this extra seat here faces reverse. So it's like the third row in a 1960s station wagon. It just goes right on the pegs. And it's a loose fit. It's just laying there. So any bumps this thing's going to encounter, that's going to rattle off. And then the extra ammo/gas can, it doesn't, like I said, there's no, this is disappointing. It doesn't tell you what these are, just says, you know, put them here. Because of the size of this and the tabs, it actually fits a little snugger. Nope, not as snug at all. So that's laying there. So, and if the seat's on this side, then that means the cannon's gonna have to probably more over to the side, because you can't have your cannon operator on top. And oh well. So again, you know, being used to the original G.I. Joe toys with more detailed instructions would have been a better help. So last but not least, let's take out the battery pack and see if this thing works out of the box, or if it's going to need some charging time. Well, this is nice. It comes with a very old 9-volt battery. And oh, so it has a, oh, here's something new. So it has a 4.8-volt battery pack. So it's essentially four AA NiCad batteries, and it's branded, and I'll do a close-up in a little bit, but it's branded with the Tonka logo. And yeah, so, and then on the back, so you have that. So, and it has a proprietary plug. So if these batteries are no good, we'll find that out. But this is also be a case where if these batteries are no good, this would need to be cut apart and new batteries essentially shrink wrapped together and rewired to continue using the plug. There's no reason in over the years for the electronics to be bad, but there is in 16 years a reason for batteries to go bad. So that's all of this. And this is the charger in here, in a nice Ziploc bag. All right, so here we go. Caution, electric electrically operated product charge only nickel-cadmium type rechargeable batteries. Other types of batteries may burst, causing injury to persons and damage. Do not remove this tag. No under penalty of law. So here we go. We got the charger. And this, again, the charger is branded with Tonka. So that indicates to me that Hasbro or Tonka were either Hasbro owned Tonka by this point, or they were still partnered with them. There were Tonka G.I. Joe vehicles during the vintage era. But this is as far as I'm going to go right now. And I guess I'm going to get a new 9-volt battery to pop into the controller. And give that a little shot of juice while I'm looking for the 9-volt. And let's see if I can get the MUV out and about and see if we can get some use out of this.
Pack did not come with any charge on it, so we're going to take this time to look at Beachhead and the G.I. Joe MUV, and we can look at the finer details and see how these stack up as a toy and a collectible. So first look at is Beachhead is reminiscent of his 1986 self, where you can see that they're using a similar color palette with the green balaclava and a black vest. Now, instead of having a vest with extra magazines of ammunition in the front, he still has that. You got some right there. You got the silver paint. You have a grenade over his left breast and some finer details. Got little pouches here. You got shoulder pads and a nice turtleneck. And also you got a nice black gloves, you know, short sleeves. You know, you have a pocket on this arm and that arm. You got nice silver metal guards for the gloves. What is notice? You can notice that the hands are a little different. This is one of the things that they did during the nose sculpt era. They had like more of an open hand and a closed hand. They will turn the wrist. So I have there's other figures where the wrist is turned, but that was one thing that they would do during the new era on these new sculpts that people don't like. You can see that the legs are kind of bow-legged, and you got, you know, one foot's turned in. You know, that is something that, again, quality control wasn't exactly on point. But you can see overall, I think it's a pretty solid toy. I like the color scheme. I like how it's reminiscent of the original 1986. One thing, we'll come in closer here, so maybe you could see those beautiful blue eyes. Yeah, they're focused. There we go. So he's got some really good blue eyes with some paint on it. That's actually a nice touch. And but just, you got a lot of nice silver accents all over. And then you can see the G.I. Joe logo right there. So, I mean, again, overall, oh, and look at that. In his back pocket, he's got some grenades, and you got some really big pockets over there. You know, you got his sidearm pistol on the right thigh. And just overall, you know, like I said, it's an O-reconstruction figure. So, you know, similar to that, you got some knee pads here. It's just I don't know. Like I said, I actually like it. You know, and you got another sidearm on the left thigh. You know, overall, I mean, if the feet weren't pigeon-toed, and, you know, I actually could almost excuse this. I could say, hey, this is actually a pretty cool figure. It's definitely going to stand out. Like you said, you put the two of the guys together, you can definitely tell the difference, you know. But that's not a bad thing. But it is, you know, it's different, you know, and different always isn't better. Different always isn't bad, but it is different. And I still think it's kind of cool. And like I said, it would be, if you had a sub collection of all the new Sculpt Arrows, I think it would be a standout figure. Against the 86, you can see it definitely stands out, but not in a way where it would mesh with the rest of the collection. I'll take a closer look at the remote control. Now you can see Spy Troops, G.I. Joe versus Cobra, military utility vehicle. And now one of the things is it is loaded up with a new 9-volt, and you can see that the red light comes on when you use it. The controls seem to have like a spring, like resistance. So it's obviously, as the harder you push it up, more effort's required. Up, down, I'm sure that's forward and reverse, and this is left and right, same thing. But I like the fact that the red light comes on, tells you that you're using it, using battery life. Now the you got the little spring right here, and the long antenna. But it's you know, 49 megahertz, and you know, and again, you got the battery cover just snaps on with the battery in there, and snaps off, and. But you have that. That's the remote control. You know, simulated screws. I don't know. Again, it was designed to be attractive, but you know, it's and it has little feet. You can stand it up there if it balances, and it's kind of sort of. You can't see it, it's out of steam, but the antenna is just wobbling back and forth like crazy. So this is the MUV, the vehicle proper. You can see it has a big gray bumper. It's got green paint on the tan, and you got the rubber wheels on the silver rims. You know, and it's, you know, and you can hear the servo turning. You got your cannon blaster with your machine gun that swivels left and right. So one of the big things you'd think is with this, you know, wherever the driver is aiming, that's where it's going to be shooting. But this, obviously, you can control elevation and left-right movement with the machine gun. Now, you know, take a look at it again. You know, you got a little spotlight here, a la a cop car. And you got, unfortunately, this is what I don't like, no glass here. Because just like, again, like I said earlier, it's just a feature that wouldn't have been left out, you know, 10, 15 years before, I believe. Just lost some value there. Overall, I said it's pretty bulky, you know, compared to the figure. You know, we'll take a beachhead here. We'll bend his knees. We'll get him in. Goes in with a minimum of fuss. And we just get his knee in. Like I said, the feet are bowed, which actually works in his favor. He can put one hand on it. Unfortunately, let me use the swivel arm. Yeah, there we go. And you can definitely tell the left hand is better for holding the steering wheel than the right. And again, we got the back here with all the foot pegs. We got all the foot pegs back there. And it is... nice, but again, you put the seat in and hear that. Yeah, exactly. It's just gonna fall out first bump you get, and that's a shame, but they go in nice. It kind of displays well. A lot more toyetic, if that's a word. It's much more of a toy than it is a vehicle you would display with and, you know, push around. It's not a vamp, it's not a hammer, nowhere near as delicate as a hammer, but it's you know, it's there. There's a lot of room, and like I said, you look at it, how small beachhead really is in the cockpit of this thing. It's, yeah, see, and I just touched that and it fell off. But you see how small beachhead's in that thing, so it's kind of, oversized, out of scale. So it doesn't work really well in that regard. But I'm hoping that when the battery's charged up, can get some good action out of this, and it can maybe make up for some of its shortcomings.
First test of the G.I. Joe MUV in real world conditions. Going to happen first on my deck. Let's go do this. First impression. The left-right works, and it looks like it is more of a digital control than an analog. So when you just tap it to the left or tap it to the right, it just goes all the way lock to lock, and we're just going to move forward. Yep, and the same thing with the reverse. Yeah. But you can see it, so yeah, you gotta tap it to go, if you want slight left or slight right, you're gonna have to go step. But yeah, get some speed going, so we'll get some good use out of that. And it burns rubber. So I'm thinking that clutch. I'm thinking clutch would have been a better driver for this.
Also, so over the course of several days, I played with the MUV, the MUV, and my thoughts are this. Overall, this is a cool toy. And as a cool toy, it's a remote control car. And, you know, it goes forward, goes backwards, stirs left and right independently, like a proper remote control car should. Battery life is short, you know, typical NiCad AA batteries in a vehicle this size don't have a long life once you start playing with it. You know, half an hour, 45 minutes is pretty good. So as a toy, it does a great job of being that. And my son enjoys it. He loves playing with it. But now as a G.I. Joe toy, it's not really that good of a G.I. Joe toy, and I'll say this, and that's because it doesn't fit in with other G.I. Joe, typical G.I. Joe toys. You know, with an APC or a snow cat or a hiss tank, you're pushing it. You're playing with the guns as you're moving it forward. And this you're not. You put the controller in, you put your figure in, and you go bombing around. So it doesn't really fit in with the other G.I. Joe toys. Do you get to put, you know, your typical 3 3/4 beachhead in the figure and bomb around? Yeah, it's great. But it doesn't fit in when you're playing with the other toys a different way. Now, if I was playing with this and I had the crossfire or the hover strike, I might be singing a different tune. But it would still, for me, I would say that the remote control vehicles would be in a separate echelon of G.I. Joe toys compared to the rest of them. Other critiques is, you know, I don't like, you know, the chair easily falling out. You know, that could have been engineered better. The scale out of proportion, yeah, typical. You know, there are other G.I. Joe motorized vehicles that are definitely much larger in scale than the character is. But then again, too, some military vehicles are out of scale and you're like, wow, that's really big and that guy's really tiny. But overall, is this a toy that you should get for your collection? Well, if you're going to play with it, yeah, absolutely. Buy it used and have fun with it. If you buy it in the box and you're going to open it up out of the box to play with it, like what I did, I wouldn't do it again. I'd invite, for what I see this going on eBay for, I would say no. Nah. You know, if you want it for your collection, you want to leave it in the box for your collection, go right ahead. If you want to find it loose for your collection, go right ahead. I wouldn't, again, take an unopened box, unless the box was trashed, and open up and play with it. I'm glad that I did, though, but I wouldn't do it again. So that's where I place it in the G.I. Joe collection. It's not really for my G.I. Joe collection anymore. It's more of a toy for my son. And I'm happy that I got him something that kind of blends the two together and, you know, gets him a little bit into G.I. Joe. But again, he's not even really after the G.I. Joe aspect. He's after the remote control car aspect at the moment. And that's really it for the G.I. Joe MUV today. And I hope you guys enjoyed this. Any questions, comments, you know, leave a comment below. And until next time. See ya.
And you've just watched Pino Comics. And if you want to subject yourself to more of Dr. Mindbender's torture, hit subscribe and hit that bell icon so you're notified when Dr. Mindbender needs you in the brainwave scanner.